Please be seated.
Mr. Ryan, or indeed Mr. Spinks, if you wish to answer. I'm just dealing with the two-witness rule, you'll recall, and I'd like to take you to your response document, Mr. O'Brien, at tab 1, page 14, paragraph 7.4. Where you set out, you say, moreover, it should be noted that sufficient scriptural evidence to establish a serious sin may consist of two or more witnesses to the same sin, or two or more witnesses to the same type of sin committed on different occasions. So the rule, leaving in the absence of a confession, requires corroboration of an allegation. Is that right?
That's correct, scripturally.
Yes, and a particular type of corroboration. Being another witness, or as it's put here, another witness to a different occasion of a similar type of sin. Is that right?
That's how I understand. Yes.
And then you go on and you say, on this basis, the scriptural rule of evidence as applied by Jehovah's Witnesses is already in harmony with the model bill, evidence, tendency, and coincidence model provisions by admitting tendency or coincidence evidence when establishing sin in their eternal ecclesiastical proceedings. Now, leaving aside the admission of evidence, let's just deal with this question of corroboration. You're aware, I take it, that the criminal courts do not require corroboration of child sexual abuse, or indeed the most heinous of sins.
Yes, I'm not clear on that particular point.
I'll ask you to accept
that. But I'll take your word for it.
Section 164 of the Evidence Act abolished the corroboration rule. So it's just misleading to say that this scriptural rule of two-witness rule is in harmony with the law of evidence. It's not in any way, is it?
I would defer to your knowledge of the law on that.
Mr. Jeffrey Jackson of the governing body gave evidence in case study 29, suggesting that there may be a role for circumstantial or corroborating evidence, such as the evident trauma suffered by a victim in determining the truth of an allegation. For those who are following, that's at transcript 15973, starting at line 37. Now, subsequent to case study 29, the rule has not been modified so as to allow circumstantial or corroborating evidence such as evident trauma suffered by a victim. Was that nevertheless considered?
I'm sure Mr. Jackson would have taken that back to for consideration in the United States, but I'm not aware of discussions on the particular point.
So we too deduce, I take it, that he was wrong in saying that there may be a role for such evidence, that it turned out there isn't a role for such evidence. Is that right?
I couldn't answer that on behalf of Mr. Jackson, sorry.
Now, if you go to the service desk guidelines at tab 6, paragraph 8, you'll see that it says, therefore, an accusation of serious wrongdoing to be established from a scriptural standpoint, there must be sufficient scriptural evidence, either a confession or testimony from two credible witnesses. Now, you'll accept, of course, that what's not included in the statement of the rule there is the additional component to it, which you speak to, which is admissibility of another witness to a separate incident of the same type of wrongdoing.
So, but that would be understood, that our policy on two witnesses.
So one has a statement here to guide the service desk, but it doesn't state the second component to the rule.
If I could, Mr. Stewart?
Yes, Mr. Spinks.
Without looking it up there, but paragraph 8... references KS 10, which is the elder shepherding manual, and those paragraphs referred to there specifically state those points. So confession.
Well, yes, I'm aware of that, but so it's there, but one has to go to another document to find it. Is that your point?
Well, I think if I could, by way of example, again, it's about audience, Mr. Stewart, the service desk know that case 10 well. So we understand that somebody else looking in would say that's the case, but if I could, by way of example, I've done my best to read almost every issue paper and report from the Royal Commission, and hundreds of hours of wading through, and there's invariably a you know, executive summary. Now, I'm not using this as a direct parallel, but this is simply an outline, an overview. The extracts of all those publications are not put in there, but that reference, could I refer to it in the KS10?
Yes, well, I've got it here. It's at tab 9, ringtail 75 at the foot of the page. It states what we've just spoken about. If there are two or three witnesses to the same kind of wrongdoing, but each one is witness to a separate incident, the elders can consider their testimony. That's what you're referring to.
Correct.
Yes. Well, where you refer to this in your joint statement, let me take you to that, tab 2, paragraph 26. So that's on page ringtail 7. Paragraph 26, the second sentence. However, in the absence of a confession of more than one witness, a single incident, the scriptural rule of evidence establishes and allows the admissibility of another witness to a separate instance of the same wrongdoing. And you see you have footnote 15 there, and it references three different documents. Do you see that?
Yes.
And the third of those documents, which is the one which has ringtail WAT00100400068 at paragraph 11. I beg your pardon. The middle of those documents is the KS10, the Shepherd book.
Correct.
Correct. At the paragraph we were looking at a minute ago, paragraph 37. Yes. But the first of those documents is a 1991 document, Pay Attention to Yourselves and All the Flock. Is that right?
But I have no reason to doubt that. I haven't got that.
And the 1991 document is of the nature of a document that goes to all the congregations, all the congregants, is that right?
I'd need to see the document. I have no reason to question what you're saying.
You'll be familiar with the document. It's the 1991, Pay Attention to Yourselves and All the Flock.
I am familiar with that publication.
So yeah. Is that for elders or for congregants?
For elders.
For elders, right. And the current elders document is the Shepherd document 2010, not so?
Correct.
So the 1991 document you reference is an out-of-date document?
That was superseded. The Shepherd manual superseded. That was a previous version.
Yes. So in February the 24th, when you sign the statement, you give an old superseded reference?
Followed by the current reference, and I believe the purpose at the time was to show a consistent process there. I mean, if you put the two together, you'll find it similar, but I don't have it in front of me.
And the third reference you give is the 1 October 2012 letter, which was replaced by the 1 August 2016 letter.
Correct.
And the August 2016 letter doesn't state this rule in this fashion. You see, Mr. Spinks, we're back to where we were in case study 29, of really struggling with just what the position is, because there's so many different conflicting documents, and we're given documents which have been superseded as authority for what's said to be current policy.
Well, Mr. Stewart, that's just incorrect.
Well, please
let me take
why.
You back to paragraph 8 again, if I could.
Paragraph 8 of what?
Of the guidelines for service desks.
Yes. That's tab 6.
Current guidelines, current reference, KS10 chapter 5 is the shepherding textbook. I, I take your point that when you're reading a statement, we've provided historical background, but I recall in the preparation of that, that was to overcome what we thought would be an obvious objection, that that's not always been the case. But the latest reference is in the footnote there, and it certainly is in the paragraph 8 of the service desk guidelines. Now, if the suggestion is that every one of those extracts should be pasted into the document, we'd be happy to consider that. But again, we're extremely familiar with that source material, and it's there in the current letter.
Well, the suggestion is that you reference out-of-date and superseded policies in support of your statement as to what the current policy is.
Mr. Stewart, again, with respect, I've just very clearly explained that the reason for that, the current policy is there, and to address what we felt would have been an obvious objection from the Commission that hadn't previously been our policy. So that's simply a footnote reference to show the existence of the policy.
Now, dealing with the subject of a victim having to confront the abuser, you know, of course, that the Royal Commission found that the Jehovah's Witness written policies and procedures should clearly state that it is not a requirement in cases of child sexual abuse that the victim must confront her alleged abuser. You know that?
Yes.
And that it was recommended that members of the organisation more generally should be advised in writing of the specific exemption that applies in cases of child sexual abuse. You're aware of that?
Yes.
And the letters to elders now make it clear that this is not required. Is that right?
That's correct.
Paragraph 13.
That's correct.
Yes. And but not the service desk guidelines. Am I right? Or have I overlooked it?
I'd have to just give me a moment. Thank you. That's correct. The August 1 letter is a wider audience. The August 1 letter is to all elders and obviously service desks. So there's quite a few examples of where the same items are not repeated in the service desk guidelines. All the service desks, by the way, and secretaries have those two items bound together because we read them together.
Now, on this specific point, this point of a victim having a right not to have to face the abuser, which is, as I've said, clarified in the 1 August letter. It's also clarified in the 7 March policy.
Correct.
But it's not been addressed in the Shepherd book, has it?
In those words, no. There was lengthy discussion at the original hearing where we went to the KS textbook and looked at what was a few brief expressions in the context of dealing with allegations in general. But I don't believe that same wording is exactly transposed into the KS 10, which I think, as we made aware to the Commission, is actually partway through editing as we speak. We provided the Commission with the adjustments that have been made to date, and we're expecting that there'll be an entire adjustment of that and made available to all elders. But it's certainly much clearer in the documents.
Mr. Spinks, that is new to me at least. So let's just unpack that. Firstly, you've made available to us, which is now at tab 9, a copy of the 2010 Shepherd the Flock of God, which is also referred to as KS10, with marginal annotations referring to certain letters to elders and other documents. That's right, isn't it?
Correct.
Right. But no actual changes to the substantive text, but if one goes to the letters, one can see where the text might have been qualified.
And I believe on your copy there as well, those are marked beside it, and that's been distributed to every elder around the world. It's actually a live document electronically now where, as those changes are being made to that book, they're made live to every congregation elder. So we've simply given you a PDF version of the live copy.
Yes, I understand that. But now the actual text of this document, am I to understand what you've just said now, is that it's in a current process of revision, and there's expected to be a new Shepherd the Flock of God edition to be produced?
That's my understanding, and that's the reason for these ongoing edits. So I would anticipate that while that is referred to in the shepherding manual, I'm happy to go there again as we did at the previous hearing, but it will certainly be clearer using the language of the current policy in any future edition.
Well, I do wish to go there. It's at tab 9, ringtail 0076, typed page 72, paragraph 39. Now, accepting that this is not dealing specifically with child sexual abuse, it's dealing with serious sin generally. That's right, isn't it?
That's correct.
It says that under the heading, if the accused denies the accusation, the investigating elders should try to arrange a meeting with him and the accuser together. And then there's a note, if the accusation involves child sexual abuse and the victim is currently a minor, the elders should contact the branch office before arranging a meeting with the child and the alleged abuser. And that would then be to the service desk.
That's correct.
Yeah, and it's the service desk guidelines, which, unlike the letter to elders, that don't have the position clearly stated that a victim has a right not to have to face her accuser.
So the service desk guidelines are very, very clear on that. And if I could just have one moment, please, Mr. Stewart. Apologise if I'm repeating something that you've clearly stated here, but in the August 1, 2016 letter protecting minors from abuse, on paragraph 13.
Yes, but that's the letter to elders.
Correct.
Yes, so I've just addressed not that letter, but the guidelines to the service desk, which is where the elders here in paragraph 39 are referred to. They're referred to the service desk.
Correct.
Yeah, and the guideline to the service desk doesn't contain an articulation of this right.
As I said to you in the letter, the
letter to the elders contains.
Sorry, if I could, Mr. Stewart, read to you paragraph 1 of the service desk guidelines.
Yes.
It says the August 1, 2016 letter to all bodies of elders provides direction in connection with protecting children from abuse. The service desk should be thoroughly familiar with that letter and pertinent information in the shepherding textbook. So again, it's audience. Yes. The letter is for all elders. The service desk guidelines are for the service desks.
Yes, I accept the things you say, you know that, and that therefore doesn't have to be in the guidelines. Not so.
Well, it is in the guidelines in that...
By reference.
Well, the letter is attached. We there are two documents side by side that we use together.
Yes, now this thing's going on to the next sentence at paragraph 39 of Shepherd. If the accuser or the accused is unwilling to meet with the elders, or if the accused continues to deny the accusation of a single witness and the wrongdoing is not established, and so I take it not established scripturally, i.e. under the two witness rule, would that be right?
That's correct.
The elders will leave matters in Jehovah's hands. So the result of that is this, isn't it? And I think it's stated in the recent policy document that even if someone who's accused of child sexual abuse is convicted beyond a reasonable doubt by a criminal court, if the scriptural rule of evidence, the two witness rule, is not met within the Jehovah's Witnesses' internal processes, then the matter is left in Jehovah's hands.
That's, again, totally incorrect, and I apologise for being direct with it, Mr Stewart, but and I'm sure it's unintentional, but you are, and the transcript will show, we've had this lengthy discussion at the first hearing. If I could be permitted to say, that bracketed section, you've gone on and read the part after it, the bracketed section is inserted there to say, when it relates to child sexual abuse, contact the branch, end of bracket. It now continues with what would be the normal judicial process that is perfectly clear to elders. I appreciate, again, it's about audience. But the bit that you read after that is not stating with regard to child sexual abuse. And in addition, you've added into the end of that statement that you just made that regardless of what the secular authorities would do, that that wouldn't permit the congregation to act when the documentation shows that's just completely incorrect.
Well, the documentation says that the service desk may then impose restrictions.
And can I, again, appreciate the different audience, Mr Stewart, but can I say to you that that does not relate, for example, to a person in a position of responsibility. This is, as you would refer to them, meeting attendants or attenders or congregation members. But in every case, steps are taken where the authorities are involved. There'd be no individual who's continuing, for example, in a position of responsibility where the secular authorities have established guilt. That situation doesn't exist.
Do you have a system of monitoring compliance with that right? In other words, the right of a victim not to have to face her abuser?
Yes.
What is your system of monitoring?
In every situation, as set out in these documents and as you've stated yourself, the elders call the legal department, they call the service department, and in every case those key issues are repeated and now, of course, in the more publicly available document.
Now, Mr O'Brien, you're aware that the Royal Commission found that members of the organisation who no longer want to be subject to its rules and discipline have no alternative but to actively leave or disassociate from the organisation, and that it found that the Jehovah's Witnesses' practice of shunning members who disassociate from the organisation potentially puts survivors in the untenable position of having to choose between constant re-traumatisation and having to share a community with their abuser or losing their entire community. So those are two findings of the Case Study 29 report. You're aware of those findings?
Yes, I'm aware of the findings, but I think we disagreed with the findings. But respectfully, I can say that. I think Mr. Jackson, in his testimony, made the same point as I did in my testimony, that we don't believe it's an impossible choice. A person can stop associating with Jehovah's Witnesses, have nothing more to do with Jehovah's Witnesses without taking the step of disassociation. We've tried to make that very clear.
Yeah, well, I'm not going to go back down that path now, having exhausted it on a previous occasion, but what I expect to find is the organisation's response to these findings in your response document of 3 January 2017. Would that be right? That's where we should go to, is that right?
That's correct, yes.
Yes. And so if we look at that document at tab 1, page 16... which is ringtail 31. I'm right at the foot of the page, 7.14.
Our January document, is it?
Yep.
Do you have that?
This is the January document?
Yes.
Yeah. 7.14.
So you say there in the first sentence, shunning a disfellowshipped child molester is and will continue to be Jehovah's Witness Bible-based response to this serious sin. Well, that depends, of course, on whether the person was disfellowshipped or reproved, doesn't it? If they were reproved, then they're not shunned.
Yes. That's correct. But the here it's talking about the child molester.
If they who is disfellowshipped, I beg your pardon, who is disfellowshipped. Yeah. But if they're not disfellowshipped, then they're not shunned, right?
No.
Right, and then goes on, this practice is an effective mechanism for protecting children in the congregation. Well, of course, I think we canvassed before that doesn't do anything for children outside the congregation. Would that be right?
Well, that's a position that's been taken. But again, we say that the congregation arrangement is one to protect the congregation from sin. We judge the matter of sin. We're not in competition with the legal justice system. And I think we've been down the road a little earlier that with reporting, we'll report that if it was mandatory reporting, that's a completely separate issue. If it's not, then we will leave that to the parent or the victim. But so it certainly...
So, Mr. Ryan, that's the first of the three paragraphs' response. We go to the next one, 7.15. You say it is not and has never been Jehovah's Witnesses' policy to shun a victim of child sexual abuse. So that says what it says. That's fine. That doesn't meet the point that's being made, which is the victim of child sexual abuse who wants to and does leave the organisation is shunned. And then 16 says the policies and procedures on how elders should respond to victims have been consolidated and clarified. Elders have been reminded and encouraged to be empathetic and compassionate to their victims and their families. They've also been directed to provide ongoing shepherding to comfort both the victim and his or her family. The elders are approached by a survivor of child sexual abuse. They should speak consolingly to the person and manifest an empathetic, compassionate, patient and supportive response. In exhorting congregation elders to lovingly and kindly serve as spiritual shepherds to victims of child sexual abuse, Jehovah's Witnesses confirm their long-standing policy that a victim will not be shunned. And I suggest to you, none of that answers the point. The point being that it's particularly damaging when a child sexual abuse victim leaves the organisation, disassociates from the organisation, and is then shunned.
Well, that would be true if they disassociate themselves, you're referring to.
Yes.
Because that is the policy. But again, I think, as I pointed out in my evidence, I think Mr. Jackson did as well, that here we're talking about somebody who is of an age where they have qualified for baptism. So they are somebody who's either approaching adulthood or an adult, making that decision, understanding the implications of choosing either to disassociate themselves, knowing the consequences will be shunning, or simply ceasing activity with the congregation, but not taking the stand of disassociation. So it's a choice on the part of the person.
Well, in brief, what you're saying is you haven't changed, in response to the Royal Commission report in Case Study 29, you haven't changed anything in relation to shunning, is that right?
Could I just read one scriptural point, because not all of the commissioners were here for the hearing, and I think this is really the basis for our thinking on these scriptural matters on which we find disagreement. So we appreciate there's disagreement. This is in the Bible book of Isaiah, chapter 33, and it talks about the laws under which Jehovah's Witnesses believe we come. Chapter 33, verse 22, it says, "For Jehovah is our judge, Jehovah is our lawgiver, Jehovah is our king." So that covers every aspect of the legislative, the executive, the judicial process. All Jehovah God reserves to himself. And we understand scripturally he delegates some of that authority to congregations, to families, husbands, wives, parents. But ultimately, if God's word provides a direction on a certain doctrine, Jehovah's Witnesses are bound by that, regardless of how others may view that.
Well, I understand that's the position you take, and I'm not going to enter into a debate with you about how, as I did on the previous occasion, about how the Jehovah's Witnesses' position on a range of things has changed over the years, on blood transfusions and blood fractions, by way of example, and on a number of other things. So we'll leave all that to one side. But just to get back to my question, which I understand the answer is yes, and the question was, in response to the Royal Commission findings and recommendations in relation to shunning in the report for case study 29, you've not made any changes?
Well, the branch committee or the directors of the Watchtower Bob and Track Society of Australia are not authorised to be able to do that, Mr. Stewart. That was a matter Mr. Jackson would have taken back to the governing body, as he said he would.
Yes, that's the point that you make, is you regard yourself bound by those policies, or to those policies, by the scriptures, and you can't change them, and therefore haven't changed them. Is that right?
Scriptural understanding, most definitely.
Could yes. I comment, Mr. Stewart?
Yes, Mr. Spinks.
I think, and again, if it's about how it's presented, we accept that. It's not our intention to be defensive, but Council assisting is repeating what was an incorrect conclusion from our perspective, and I say that with respect, where you're actually asking, have Jehovah's Witnesses changed something that they never did? So I think where the confusion comes in, and Mr. O'Brien has nicely explained that if somebody chooses to take a different course and remove themselves, disassociated, that's a matter for them. But victims of child sexual abuse are not shunned. There's no evidence.
Unless they disassociate, then they are. That's the point.
But again, what you're suggesting there is that the congregation makes a decision to shun a victim. If a victim or a survivor makes that decision themselves, then they understand the implications. There's not a situation where someone has disassociated because they're a victim of child sexual abuse, but we just wanted to make that point again.
I think the real issue is that for some people, the circumstances will be such that they just can't stay, and they will find it necessary for their own survival, effectively, to disassociate. But the consequence of that is they are shunned and lose all of their prior social structure. That's the issue. And you heard the evidence that some people gave about that issue. That's the problem.
If I could, Your Honour, with respect...
That doesn't happen in other parts of society, generally.
Again, Your Honour, with respect, and I certainly don't want to be protesting a point...
Say what you believe to be true.
Thank you for that. The Commission has consistently, and we respect the right of the Commission to draw the conclusions and Council assisting, but the Commission has consistently failed to acknowledge that individuals who want to leave the organisation of Jehovah's Witnesses, no longer be an active member, can do that. By conflating someone choosing to no longer be an active member and someone specifically disassociating themselves, saying, I just don't agree with the organisation anymore, I don't want to be a part of it, are two totally separate things. And again, with respect, we just make the point that...
That was inherent in what I just put to you, but the consequence of dissociation, as we understand it, is that that person will be shunned, and that means they lose contact with family, friends and everyone else who remains inside the Jehovah's Witness organisation. Is that right?
Again, Your Honour, the person...
Your colleague is nodding. Is that right or not?
Well, because you've said disassociated, Your Honour, but he or she can choose to be no longer an active member of the congregation.
I understand that, but if they are so unable to cope with what's happened and the way they've been treated inside the organisation, that they dissociate, then they lose all of their previous social structure. Is that right?
That could be the case, and we respect their right to make that decision.
Well, it's a pretty cruel way of dealing with someone, isn't it, who has suffered sexual abuse.
I could only repeat what I said, Your Honour.
No, but it's cruel, isn't it? To take away, by reason of the rules that you impose, all of their social structure. That's cruel.
Could I just interrupt, Your Honour? I believe with the difference between disfellowshipping and disassociation, the congregation takes the action in disfellowshipping somebody who is then shunned. The person who disassociates himself, they're taking the action. Now, for whatever reason, I agree, and maybe not even with regards to being a victim, others make the same decision. But they are actually taking the stand to shun the congregation from themselves. That, and they understand the implications of that. Now, it is, I agree, it puts them in a difficult situation, but it is a choice.
You see, someone who comes to you and says, I was sexually abused, but because there's no two witnesses, you don't accept it. You don't make that finding. They're left in a very difficult position, aren't they?
If they choose not to report it to the authorities, then...
Well, for whatever reason, if the organisation doesn't acknowledge that they were abused, that imposes a great burden on them, doesn't it?
If I could again respectfully say, Your Honour, we don't disbelieve a person who makes an accusation. That's why we investigate every accusation brought forth by the elders.
Yes, but if there's not two witnesses, you don't accept it, do you?
Because scripturally we're not able to.
I know. And that, you would understand, can be very, very distressing for someone who has come to you with that complaint, can't it?
Certainly. Not being a victim is very distressing. Whatever consequences come, yeah, we agree.
And that can lead to a chain of circumstances where that person feels unable to do other than dissociate from your organisation.
Could I respectfully, Your Honour, say we don't want to be defensive and we acknowledge that disassociation or disfellowshipping certainly have implications. An individual can choose to be inactive. Could I use a parallel that in my careful reading of the issue papers from the Commission, and some of it I don't understand, most of it I have, it's been very well put together and the summaries. One reference said that only reporting is low across the community. One study that's not suggesting the Commission validated it, but it was just referenced. One study in this country suggested that only 10% of child abuse allegations, and I believe it was in New South Wales, but I'll be corrected on that, lead to a conviction, and only around half of those lead to a custodial sentence. I mention that simply to say that if on an occasion a victim of child abuse has felt that where Jehovah's Witnesses have taken a Bible-based stand, my heart also goes out to the thousands of victims who've come forward and asked for help. It's not resulted in a conviction, or if it has, only half of those result in a custodial sentence. So I just put it in the context that we are extremely aware of the damage that is done where the victim, it's compounded by the action that we, the police or the courts take. And in that context, we absolutely, absolutely agree with you.
I understand what you say, but can I just ask you this simple question? Why is it necessary when someone feels that they can no longer abide the organisation and has to dissociate, why is it necessary to shun them? Why can't they keep having social contact with those people who happen to remain in the organisation?
Well, I'd say again, and we're going to appear very repetitive, I apologise, Your Honour, but the individual can choose.
Why is it necessary for the organisation to tell all of its adherents, you must shun that person?
Because the individual has not taken the decision to no longer associate or to no longer be involved with congregation activities, which is their right, they've taken the decision to say, I'm shunning the congregation, I'm no longer a part of the congregation, I put it in writing. So the individual takes that action and we understand the implications. When someone is disfellowshipped, the congregation takes that action. So the individual does not need to put themselves in a position where they're shunned. They can walk away, they can go to another congregation. That's their personal choice, but we understand and agree with the point you're making, Your Honour.
Well, you haven't answered the point, but we'll move on.
The question is dismissed. You have not answered His Honour's question. His Honour's question is, why is it necessary to shun the person who disassociates? And before you answer, let me clarify one thing. The person who disassociates, both you and Mr. O'Brien have now said it, you said that they shun the organisation. They don't necessarily at all. You're talking about someone who just doesn't want to be part of it anymore. They still want to have their friends, their family, and and everything else, their social network. So I accept that kind of person, but he disassociates. Now, why is it necessary to have a policy that everyone else must now shun them?
Again, that's a decision the person makes, individual...
Sphinx, that is an answer.
Mr. Stewart, I don't think we're going to get anywhere. I think we should...
Well, the real answer to the question is because you say the Bible says so. That's the answer, isn't it?
That's our understanding of the scriptural disfellowshipping and disassociation doctrine.
I should just say also that in relation to the point that Mr. O'Brien, you made, and Mr. Spinks as well, I think, and that's that a person can become inactive without disassociating and in that way not be shunned. Now, without going through that evidence again, I just want to say to you that that's highly contested by a lot of people as to whether that is possible. I know you say that's the case. A lot of other people say it isn't.
I'm sorry, I misunderstood, but...
The simple point is, and I'm not going to... I'll let you respond, but I'm not going to go down this path. We went down it before. The simple point is this. A person who... does not want to be active in the organisation anymore, in order to avoid being shunned, must disassociate. There isn't a category of membership of inactive and nevertheless welcome.
Sorry, Mr. Stewart, that's...
I know you disagree, that's
well, when we've put it in print, I mean...
The only point I'm making is that that's not accepted.
Again, we can apologise, Your Honour has... said we're repeating the point, but we have a very clear understanding of the difference between someone being inactive, no longer an active member of the congregation, and someone who takes a decision to disassociate. That clear to us, but we agree to disagree.
Going on to the question of redress, you don't actually have a policy with regard to how to handle claims that are brought against the organisational claims made, not necessarily in a court, but someone says, look, I was abused in the organisation one way or another, I want compensation for this, so I want it to be dealt with. You don't have a policy that deals with that, do you?
We're certainly in the process of developing that, particularly since the release of the paper on redress from the Royal Commission. We've studied that and we're basically in agreement with many of the proposals in there. We don't take the view that we're waiting just until we hear the final thing, but there still are a number of questions that it seems to be have to be resolved.
And that's this 2015 Royal Commission report on redress and civil litigation that you're referring to, is that
right? Yes, that's right.
Okay, so that's been around for a couple of years now, but in short, you're saying you're working on a policy which we can expect at some stage?
Well, it's only in recent months we have had one request some time ago, probably more than a year ago, that we corresponded back with, and the claimant changed the solicitors they were using. So it's only just in the last, this week, the last few days, that we've received a report back from the legal firm that we've been using to deal with the requests that have come in.
Well, never mind individual cases. Can I just understand this from you? Is it the case that you're working on a redress policy and one can expect to see one in due course?
Yes, definitely.
Thank you. And has the organisation engaged with or reached a position on the Commonwealth Government's proposed national redress scheme that was announced in November last year?
No, not at this stage. Could I raise a question on this, which is of concern to us in being able to address this issue of redress, Mr. Stewart? Would that be acceptable?
Well, let's hear what it is, Mr. O'Brien, and then I can tell you whether we can answer it or not.
Okay, so with regard to the finding of the Royal Commission, with our bringing in all of the case files that we had, because of their being investigated, the finding was that that makes all of them institutional abuse, even though the greater majority of them were not actually according to the terms outlined in the redress scheme. as being institutional. So there's two implications for that that I would see. One of them for us as an organisation, if the number of case files is the basis for determining our share in a redress scheme, we would feel that would be not in the interest of being fair and adequate because...
You needn't worry about it. Your organisation came clearly within our terms of reference because we are required to look at the response of your organisation.
Yeah, which we don't contest.
And that response, of course, when inadequate, will cause damage to people. You understand that?
We understand, yes. That's your response.
And from the evidence that we've had, that is likely to have happened. You may not be an organisational abuser as such, but the response of your organisation may have compounded, indeed very much compounded, the damage to that individual. As far as the redress scheme is concerned, if it takes the form, or roughly the form the Commission has recommended, your liability will be determined on a case-by-case basis,
right,
and you'll be contributing on a case-by-case basis.
Yes, so that's...
Files that we send off to the police, well, may or may not represent a part of your liability. I don't know.
Okay, so according to then the terms set out, I think it was on page 38 on the redress and civil liability, the recommendations, it outlined just what constituted institutional abuse. If that's as we understand it, then that would be something we would... that would resolve some of the issues we have in our mind.
Well, you must understand, Mr. O'Brien, that this was the recommendation of the Royal Commission. This has now been taken up by the Commonwealth Government, and the government's in a process of consulting the states and territories and organisations, and how it will end up may be close or not so close to what was recommended, one doesn't know. So my simple question is to what extent is your organisation engaging in that process or taking a position on whether it should engage in that process?
So at the moment, we haven't had any actual statement of claims, but we have had correspondence from six individuals. So we're formulating on the basis at the moment, still trying to determine what sort of extent of claims we would have, because I do understand from the report that each organisation would still be responsible for their own claims, which is part of the recommendation. If that was what the National Redress Scheme brought in, that possibly will affect which institutions and states would opt in for that. So I think it's still a little bit too unclear for us to commit ourselves definitively. We're still working through the process of determining just how we will handle
redress. You haven't ruled it out.
We haven't ruled it out, and we certainly, if there are any victims who are victims through institutional abuse from Jehovah's Witnesses, we would do everything in our power to assist them financially and spiritually.
And then finally, dealing with the question of the involvement of women in decision-making in the organisation. You're aware of the findings in relation to that. I won't repeat them. Your response is given tab 1, paragraph 7.5 and 7.6. So 7.5 is a broad statement. 7.6, you say women can and do participate in the process of presenting allegations of child sexual abuse to the elders. So I take it you mean that as a matter of ongoing practice that happens. Is that what you're saying, Mr. Brown?
This is to do, again, with the entire process of receiving an accusation, to the completing of giving support to a victim. So the role of women in the process, the only restriction that Jehovah's Witnesses have on that is in the actual judicial committee, which is dealing with the perpetrator, not dealing with the victim.
Yes.
So women can be involved in the entire process. The victim never has to confront the perpetrator, doesn't have to sit in on the judicial committee.
That's the point, isn't it? Your answer in relation to decision-making is that you are scripturally bound, that the decisions can only be made by men.
Yes, once again, that's a scriptural requirement that we adhere to.
And at the end of that paragraph, 7.6, you say, see paragraph 13 of the August 1 letter. I take it that's in support of the statement that complainant may be accompanied by a confidant, etc. That reference seems to be wrong because paragraph 13 at tab 7 doesn't say anything about that.
I might just get Mr. Spinks to comment on that. Is the expertise in the letter?
So, again, for the very reason you raised, Mr. Stewart, we've acknowledged that. And so in the current Australian safeguarding policy, and we've made the very recommendation that you've just raised, the March 2017 child safeguarding policy.
Tab 11.
Paragraph 10. Number 10.
Yeah.
Says, again, a victim's never required to confront his or her alleged abuser. The allegation can be made in the form of a written statement. And then two sentences on, adults who were victims of child abuse may be accompanied by a confidant of either gender to provide them with moral support when meeting with the elders. So, again, it's a valid point.
I just want to come back to something I dealt with early on, in case I didn't understand it clearly. This document you're looking at now, it's been approved by the branch committee, but not yet finalised in case you want to make amendments following this hearing. Is that right?
We were ready to distribute it and made the observation that if something is said at the public hearing that needs to be clarified, then that's what we want to do. But our understanding at this stage is it's completed and subject to any other observations that we can include in it, but that's correct.
Right, so you anticipate then finalising it shortly, would that be right, in the next week or two?
Mm. That's correct.
Yes. And then to whom is it going to be published exactly?
To congregation members.
To all congregation members.
So that's the audience for this document, and is all congregation
members.
And how
will that be done?
Well, that's the decision the branch committee has got to make, whether we're going to do that in a printed form or whether it's going to be distributed through the electronic mailing system for each congregation and made available locally. That's either way, it's available to all congregation members.
But you give the undertaking now that it, let me rephrase it, the undertaking now that the intention is that it be distributed to all congregation members.
Yes,
that's the audience for this document and, sorry, Mr.
Yeah, I can speak on behalf of the branch committee on that, who are authorised to make that available, that it will be available to every member of every congregation in Australia.
Well, making it available may be something different to what I'm speaking about, because making it available could be if someone asks for it, they can have it. I'm just seeking to determine whether it's actually going to be actively distributed so that people have access to it without having to ask for it.
So if I could, sure. I'm not a part of the branch committee, but the recommendation that we've made, and I believe will be acceptable, that every congregation member will have it made available to them, whether that's through a paper distribution or an announcement or made available at the Kingdom Hall. That's the only decision that's got to be made. But every congregation member will be made aware of it and a copy made available to them in each of the 800 congregations around the country.
You'll understand and accept that to the extent that people's rights within the organisation are articulated in this document, they need to
know what those are. And
Absolutely.
Yes. I have nothing further, Your Honour.
Mr. Tockley, do you have any questions?
No, Your Honour, there's no re-examination.
Before we close, I have one question. I want to refer you back to paragraph 1716 of tab 1. It's paragraph 716 of tab 1.
716.
What's on the screen is not that. I would summarise that as, in its totality, as indicating what we would describe as a pastoral response. Do you think that's an accurate description?
I don't understand the question. I apologise.
Well,
a religious response.
Yes, pastoral means looking after the flock.
Yes.
I mean, this is about empathy and compassion and so on. And that's all very well as it goes, but you would now understand from the Royal Commission's work that the often very grievous effects of child sexual abuse are life-changing and life-affecting, and therefore people need, and I stress independent, expert independent therapeutic intervention, sometimes called counselling, but it can be better described as I put it. I want to know, in terms of your response to the 1,006 files of victims and subsequent victims that have come to your attention, whether the Jehovah's Witnesses branch in Australia have assisted or decided to assist or planned to assist victims or survivors with respect to therapeutic intervention by independent experts?
Yes, so on that, Commissioner, we of course allow the individual to decide who they would like to use, but certainly we will assist in funding any of the victims who fall into that category automatically under the terms of reference of the redress scheme. We would see part of the redress would be covering medical and ongoing psychological or psychiatric help or some other form of...
And you do that presently?
No, because we haven't had any actual claims or correspondence until this last mainly 6 to 8 months. And it's only just at the point now that the legal firm we're using, Gilchrist Connell, have now written to the solicitors of the victims and have now presented us with some suggestions for consultation.
Well, this is not really about the law. It's about going further than compassion and actually providing people help for grievous psychological harm. Surely you're not going to wait until 2018 when a redress scheme finally comes up to reach out to victims and survivors?
No, not at all, Commissioner, because we have already now been in contact with these, so the ones who've made claims. We're not actively going out looking for other victims because we don't know what the situation is with them. But those who've corresponded to us, who've sought some form of redress or compensation, we're at the point now where we can address it long before 2018.
Well, perhaps I could ask through you, Mr. Stewart. If you could give us some formal advice as to whether you are assisting anyone at present with financial help for independent therapeutic advice as a branch.
We'll follow that up, Commissioner.
Nothing further. Nothing arising from that, Mr. Tockley.
No, there's nothing to be done.
Very well, thank you. That brings this particular hearing to an end. And thank you both for your contribution. And you are now excused, and we'll adjourn until 2 o'clock.
We'll stand.